Okay, I don't have any slides or anything. I just thought rather than have a lightning talk session with only one talk, I would come up and say something about my research. So my name's Robert Miles. I'm a PhD student at the University of Nottingham, and I'm working on artificial immune systems. So if anybody interested in machine learning, cool, interesting algorithms, or just, I think my research is really cool. So I want to talk about it. A lot of people don't even know that this field of artificial immune systems exists. The idea is, if you're familiar with artificial neural networks, these are algorithms which are designed to copy the way that neural networks work in the brain. You study the biology of the neurons, and you figure out some kind of simplified mathematical model of how neurons work, and then you can generate, you make a computer simulation of those neurons, and you can then train them to solve tasks. And these are quite commonly used tools now in machine learning. And the idea of artificial immune systems is to do the same kind of thing where you steal from biology, you imitate biology, whatever, but copying the human immune system, which does not get nearly enough credit. The human immune system is amazing. Biologically, it's a fantastic system. And in fact, it qualifies by most definitions as a cognitive system. If you think about what the immune system is capable of, it's able to recognize that it's under threat. It's able to recognize threats that it's never seen before, right? Newly evolved bacteria, it will recognize them. It will identify a way of responding, and it then develops that response in real time, which is an unbelievable achievement that people don't think about. Bacterial generations are extremely short, right? They can out-evolve us immediately. So how are we not just being killed by viruses and bacteria constantly? We have systems that can learn and adapt in real time, right? And those systems also have memory, which is another key component of a cognitive system. You get chickenpox once as a child. Your system learns how to beat it, remembers how to beat it. You can't get chickenpox again. And it's also very robust, right? In machine learning, there are two types of mistakes you can make, the false positive and the false negative. In the human immune system, a false positive is something like an allergy or an autoimmune disease where the immune system registers something as a threat, which isn't really a threat. That can be annoying, you know, like hay fever, or it can be can completely kill you. False negatives, similar situation, the immune system failing to register on something which is a problem. And if that happens, you are dead, right? Either of those situations, very serious. So the immune system has developed to be extremely effective at robustly classifying things into dangerous and not dangerous. So maybe we'd like to be able to steal this capability. Maybe we'd like to be able to imitate it. The most obvious application is computer antivirus, right? If we could have an antivirus that works the way the human immune system works, the problem is essentially solved. Because it's not commonly known the way that current antivirus works. It's basically just a list, right? There's everything that has been identified as a threat is added to a list. You download the list regularly and check for the things on that list. It's generally not much cleverer than that. I think we can do better. So that's the idea of artificial immune systems. Study the biology, steal the mechanisms of action, create computer algorithms that behave in that same robust way. So the algorithm that I'm working on, working with, I guess, is called the dendritic cell algorithm, which works by copying a specific type of cell in the body, the dendritic cells, which are sort of like little detective cells, effectively. They actually move around the body, and they collect a lot of information about what's going on, what antigen is present, basically, in the tissue, which is anything that's sort of biological molecules of various kinds. So bacteria will produce and in the process of their metabolism, they produce certain chemicals, which it looks for. And it also looks for signals produced by the cells themselves. So healthy cells will produce certain chemicals that indicate that the cell is happy and healthy and operating in the way that it should be. And if a cell believes itself is under attack, it's under stress in some way, it's under threat of destruction, it releases certain other signals, chemical signals, which are sort of distress signals. And by moving around and collecting these two things, what's going on and is the tissue okay, it's then able to correlate those two together and answer the question of what is causing a problem, right? So if these cells are moving around and they come across some particular molecular signature that they haven't seen before, they don't necessarily trigger the alarm if there's no damage. If all of the human cells are perfectly happy, then the immune system isn't triggered. This is why, this is what happens when you try and do a talk with absolutely zero planning. I should have gone back and explained the danger model versus the self-non-self model. Basically, it's a relatively recent change in immunology. People used to think that the immune system detected things in your body that didn't originate there. That's the most simple idea, right? They go around, they check, is this part of my body or is it not? And it turns out that that's not how it works, because there's all kinds of things living in us which are actually no harm to us. Things like our gut flora or various other kind of semi-symbiotic organisms and microorganisms that aren't causing us any problem and therefore don't justify an immune response. So it turns out the way that it works is by detecting damage, which is what I was saying before. So now, because I went on a digression and now I'm lost. What was I, help me out here, what was I talking about? Yeah, before I took that diversion, what was I talking about? Dendritic cells. Yes, so they go, thank you. They go around the tissue and they collect this information, and then if they perceive enough danger, they report back to a lymph node where they sort of dump everything that they've seen. They say, right, they kind of report in saying, I was just in some tissue, which I'm telling you now was under attack. I don't know what was carrying out the attack, but here's everything I've got. Here's everything I collected while I was out going around the tissue. And the lymph node collects that. And then if it gets enough dendritic cells coming in and saying, I was in tissue that was under attack, here's what I've found, and they've got something in common, there's a particular kind of smoking gun that is found in all of the cells that came back from damaged tissue and not found in the cells that came back from healthy tissue, it's then able to identify it and pretty much just hand that off to the T cells, which are the vast, I mean, they're tiny, obviously, but relative to other cells, they're vast. The killer T cells, right? Which are the things that hunt down and envelop and destroy invading bacteria. Obviously, this is massively oversimplified, but this is the basics of how it works. So, the idea then is, from that model, we've designed and built an algorithm that works in a simplified way that you can feed information from a computer system in a computer security context. You sort of build a big analogy, it's a big metaphor, where the computer is a body and the processes are the computer processes are the biological processes. It's kind of a quite a tight analogy in that most of the names are the same, right? You're still trying to stop viruses. And long story short, it works fairly well. It's still very early stage. It can't be released. How long have I been talking for, by the way? I don't have a sense of that.
It doesn't matter.
Oh yeah, there's nobody, I'm not making anybody else late. Yes, anyway, this is cool research, is what I'm saying. It's kind of interesting, and a lot of people don't know that it's even a field, so I'm letting you all know. artificial immune systems, they're a lot of fun. Yes, questions?
A little bit off topic. You mentioned chickenpox. The body learns how to defeat it, and then we will know how to defeat it.
Mm-hmm.
How come that even goes into our genome and carried on to the next generation?
It does.
Would you please repeat the question?
Sorry. So the question, and correct me if I'm misinterpreting this, is if the body is able to learn, for example, how to defeat chickenpox, and then will then be able to defeat it again immediately if it's re-exposed, why doesn't this go into our genome so that we actually evolve to permanently be immune to chickenpox? And basically the answer to that is, I'm not actually an immunologist. I know enough immunology to do the computer science. But my understanding is that there's a vast, vast difference in the speed that we can evolve compared to the speed that bacteria can evolve and viruses can evolve, because we are very large animals that live a very long time. We can't reproduce at all for decades after we're born. So. And also because we're sexually reproducing animals, there's a limit to how much mutation we can have in any one generation, because you still need to be compatible. So it means that we evolve very slowly, basically. Whereas bacteria, when they if there's a single bacterium gets a single mutation which is helpful, it can divide 10,000 times, you know, and a single generation, I don't know what it is, but it can be, in optimal conditions, it can be the course of hours for it to split and then split again and split again. So because bacteria evolve so much quicker than we do, any defenses that we manage to evolve, they can immediately counter in relative timescales, because they just out-evolve us. And the fact that the human immune system is so clever is the only way that we actually manage to... the only way that we actually manage to survive at all under the constant onslaught that... If you leave something out, you get some meat, leave it out on a plate, whatever. How long until that meat is completely destroyed and crawling with parasites and bacteria? Not very long, right? And in principle, the only thing standing between us and that is our immune system, right? Every single day, you're fighting off all of that attack that would happen to that piece of meat. Skin is handy, but if you leave the skin on the... Also, the skin is an immune organ, like it is part of the immune system. But even if you leave the skin on a piece of meat, it's still gonna go pretty quickly. So the answer is that they just evolve quicker than we do. Yeah? Right, they physically go there. It's kind of cool. There's a protein on the surface which causes them to bind to other cells, and the extent to which they express this protein increases by the amount of danger that they've seen. And then once it reaches a certain threshold, they will stick to a nearby cell, and they sort of roll towards the nearest lymph node, because from, you know, on each cell there's kind of a chemical gradient of I can't remember what it is, but there's a chemical gradient towards each lymph node, the nearest lymph node, and so once they stick, they gradually sort of roll towards it, and then when they get there, I believe they actually they're actually destroyed. They just sort of open up and spill everything out into the lymph node, along with the, it's kind of sacrificial. It's pretty metal, actually. But, you know, they're not conscious, so who cares? Yeah. Yeah? Oh, sorry. Hi. You're next. Mm-hmm. Right, yes.
Is it possible to summarize that?
Not easily. I'll try. So there were kind of a couple of parts to that question, and I've now forgotten them. Can you, like, bullet points? Okay. Mm-hmm. Right. Right. Okay, I'll do the second one because I know the answer to it. So the question is how easy is it to find a damage analog that will work in some other context than the body, right? Is that what you're saying, in a machine learning context? It is kind of a problem. So what's commonly done in the computer security example that I gave before, there were earlier, it actually combined with existing antivirus systems that were looking at experimental antivirus systems that were looking at things like network traffic patterns that, for example, like a worm will produce a particular pattern of network traffic when it's doing a ping scan, for example, to try and find other hosts on the network to infect. And so if you have something that can detect that, there are a lot of these sensors which you have to just put a threshold on. You say, right, how likely is it right now that there's a ping scan going on from this host? And the existing systems, there's just a threshold. If it exceeds a certain level, then somebody gets an email saying, we think somebody is attacking our network, and then the human being can respond. Whereas with the dendritic cell algorithm, you can take that output from the network monitoring tool, which is continuous, and use that as one of the danger signals. You sort of put them into a matrix and just multiply them all by some constants according to how important you think they are. You know, you weight them. And it will then be able to tell you not just is a ping scan going on, but which process is responsible. And then you have the capacity for an automated response, right? Because you don't need to send an email to someone. You can just send a kill signal to the process and kill it because you strongly suspect that it's involved in some kind of attacking behavior. In general, figuring out the damage analog is one of the harder parts of building the analogy. Yeah, exactly. And you can do, you can find those programmatically if you build a big data set in which you deliberately run some attacks and then compare and do PCA on it and find the ones that are most important and then, you know. I don't know. I mean, there haven't actually been very many applications of this yet, other than this one. But yeah, that's a big open area that people are looking at. You had one?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. The question is, we're taking from computer from biology and going to computer science. Could we potentially go the other way? I hope so. Really, not my department. But this is why actually, the field is called artificial immune systems. There are journals for artificial immune systems, and I hate the phrase artificial immune systems. I think it's rubbish because it's deeply confusing to people. Like, I have more than once now received messages from people who have read online that I'm working on artificial immune systems and they or some family member has some horrible autoimmune disease. And they want to know if I can help. And it's just the most, it's so heartbreaking to be like, no, I'm just making antiviruses and stuff. It's not, you know. Nothing. Not only can I not help you, but I don't believe there's anyone who can do better than the current immunologist. So, you know. talk to your doctor, sorry. So I prefer to call it, I actually prefer to call it immune-inspired computing, because that's really what it is. I can understand where people came from with that, because an artificial neural network isn't really doing the work of a neural network, but an artificial immune system is just simulating one, because it's not a purely information-based process. You actually have to physically kill the bacterium or whatever. But yeah, in the future, molecular nanotechnology will totally do it. You know, give it time. 2045, that's hard date. January 1st, 2045, we'll have it. Yes? That's a really good question. Yeah, so why can we learn how to defeat chickenpox and we can't learn how to defeat other things with our immune systems, right? Is that a fair assessment of what you said? Yeah, I don't know. Again, that would be great if we could figure out what it is about that particular, well, about that range of attacks that we can detect and remember and respond to appropriately. That would be like a huge advance in medicine in general, but no, I don't know, and I'm not certain that anyone does, but don't quote me on that. Yeah? I can't really hear you, sorry. Yes. Yeah, so there's almost nothing that can't be used for evil, right? I mean, almost anyone's research. So the question is basically, can this be used for surveillance and, oppressive, whatever. I mean, so I'm a card-carrying member of the Open Rights Group. I care about this stuff. I gotta say, my research, I'm not concerned about it. There's a whole load of machine learning stuff that has really big and serious applications in that field. And there was a talk about that, wasn't there? About privacy. I remember reading about one. Like big data and its consequences for privacy or something. There are people in my department working on some stuff that does creep me out, but not my work. No, I don't see that. I don't see the application, to be honest.
Sir, can we have? Oh, we're just gonna like kind of run up a bit, but sir, can we have your name, please?
I'm Robert Miles.
Robert Miles. Okay, yeah. Guys, would you like put your hands together for Robert Miles? He's come out of the blue and he's been fantastic.